Hello, this is Servan from Conscious Innovation. And at the moment, we're digging deep into the concept of trust through our learning project called The House of Trust. And it's aimed at people who love to invest in and positively influence social change. Trust is a vast topic, touches our political systems, our communities, our companies, our families, and also our inner lives. So there are never enough conversations or explorations about trust. How can we use that to activate change? So with this in mind, I'm thrilled to welcome Melanie Stack, an international leader and a close friend. We've seen each other for, you know, more than 10 years, so 11 years already, right?
Yeah, we were just saying 10 years. Actually, yeah. As you say, nearly 11. It's amazing.
And there we go. We are here today speaking about trust. So Mel, I just want to ask you if you can introduce yourself and say, you know, what your main line of work has been to date.
Okay, so hi everybody, I'm Melanie. I have spent many years working for various businesses across the UK and Europe and the US and Canada most recently. I've always followed my passions. So I've worked in industries and businesses where I can see a real connection or feel a real connection as a consumer, like the toy industry and in weight loss and many others. I spent some time when I first got to know you working in the social enterprise sector, and that's something I'm really keen to get back to. So I'm taking a short sabbatical now to kind of look at new investments and new opportunities in that space too.
So you said you've been working around the toy industry, but also in the weight loss industry. And I believe there's a sort of there's a good nest to speak about trust here, isn't it?
Yes. I think I always said in both my many years at Weight Watchers and more recently with Ideal Protein in our clinics in the US and Canada that you know, our clients, our weight losers, our patients put the ultimate trust in our hands. Mm. And when they did that, we owed them a duty of care, and we had to be a trusting organization, because when your consumer is trusting you to deliver changes in their life and their lifestyle, it's a huge responsibility.
Mm. So now that is just a perfect segue to clarify, what is your personal definition of trust, actually?
Gosh, well, when you asked me that question and when I looked at the questions, I kind of looked it up because I was thinking maybe I have a kind of distorted view based on my own experiences. And the kind of definitions that I found on the internet were, you know, somebody who has a firm belief in the reliability, the truth, or ability of someone or something. Mm-hmm. And actually, you know, I kind of thought that's what's driven me for many, many years. I've always worked well in teams. I took on kind of people leadership responsibilities very early in my career because, I mean, it's a cliche to say, but I am a people person and I tend to trust first and build relationships on that basis.
It's very generous as well.
Is it generous or is it? I mean, some people are wired to be optimistic and trusting. I guess some of it's in personality and wiring, but some of it is, you know, my experience is it's not generous, it's common sense. You know, everybody has their talents, everybody has their strengths. And if you want to build strong relationships and bring out the best in people and, you know, even kind of at a more efficiency end, optimized performance, you have to have trust as the foundation of a relationship. It's common sense to me, really. Mm.
So that reminds me of a story of a friend of ours who is in Sweden and active also in the same social impact sector. And she had the opportunity one day to have a palm read. Mm-hmm. You know, fortune teller, which is not a usual thing to do, but there you go, that happened. And of course, she got the story, and the woman said to her, well, you know, you're going to be let down. Someone you trust is going to let you down. And Miriam actually didn't think much more of it and stayed absolutely placid or just or didn't make much a fuss about it. And the fortune teller was quite startled. So what do you mean? It doesn't startle you. Well, if nobody let me down, that would have meant that I wouldn't have given trust in the first place. So it's fine.
It's so true. It's so true. I mean, it's a human, what is it? It's a human truth in terms of people will let you down if if you create trust and you create space and you empower people, but not because people are bad or they, you know, I mean, one of my philosophies is, and one I learned very early on in some leadership training I did probably 30 years ago, was the whole concept of positive intent. You know, people get up in the morning, most people get up in the morning and want to do a good job, want to have ideas, want to be creative, want to make an impact in whatever job they do. And, you know, they're not, nobody's deliberately trying to kind of jeopardize or undermine. So if somebody lets you down, it's often without intent or without realizing, or because you're looking at it through your lens of what you wanted. Everybody's different and everybody behaves differently. So positive intent is really important to me. Being curious, particularly in the context of, you know, you talked about let down and understanding why people do the things they do. It's that another great learning I had was about this concept of always looking below the waterline. I mean, it's like the big iceberg. Above right. The waterline is people's behavior, but the 9/10 of how they feel, how they're wired, what drives them, what's happened is under the waterline. And you never know what's going on when somebody does something that, in inverted commas, may let you down. So, being curious, being open. And then fundamentally, we are all wired to be unique and different. And I think one of my huge career learnings is, you know, I've interviewed people in the past that are just not like me and are just not wired like me. And in some instances, you think we are never going to get along. And they're the people I'm always most curious about, because it's the people who are most different, who you learn about over time, who often make the biggest impact because they are bringing something completely different to you. We're all wired to kind of fill our businesses or our teams or our communities with people we, you know, we relate to because they're our tribe, but it doesn't make for a lot of difference often.
And that's where it fails. When we talk about gender equality, we've been talking about gender equality for a while together. And the same old problem. If you attract your likes, your people who think like you, that's never going to get there, are we? So, okay, let's recap. We got positive intent, curiosity, openness, and looking for what's unique and different and accepting that we are unique and different. And that's something that sometimes a bit of a counter flow, as you say, because we trust the people who we recognize, right?
Yes.
What more do you think about or want to say about around that philosophy for building trust?
I think the diversity point is important. Always looking for people who bring something different. And then I think if you have a foundation that is about trust, then you start with that respect for the positive intent, and you start by wanting to learn and understand why. And I think that's what builds great communities, builds great teams, and addresses fear. I think, you know, and I don't want to be too political, but we're growing up in a world where a lot's happening. There's a lot of fear. Our whole media and political system is based on kind of this climate of fear. And that's why I just love the work you're doing with this House of Trust. It's like if we could just learn to trust and be more open to people who don't think like us, don't behave like us, don't do the things we do, then, you know, I think a lot of change is possible. And that's where creativity and ideas come from. They always come from the place you least expect them.
Mel, do you have a story about something that you least expected around trust, whether it was you had been maybe very curious, open, and accepted difference, and then it didn't work out at all, and you discovered something new? Was there a story of learning around trust that you would like to share with us?
I think probably in my last position with Ideal Protein in the States, you know, when I came into the business, there were a lot of challenges. The business was based in Canada, and in those days we could travel because COVID wasn't prevalent. This was back in 2018. And I'd heard so many stories about our clinics that were frustrated, who were running the program, our field teams who were frustrated and difficult. And the Canadian team would sort of say, oh, you know, the field team are just so challenging to work with. They're so demanding. The clinics are difficult. And I just spent a few weeks touring around the US, asking questions and meeting the team. And I can tell you that, you know, there were a lot of challenges with that business in the early days. I mean, I went in to turn around the business, but you just had to listen and understand. And the ideas, the plan that we built with the Canadian team to turn the business around, all came from our clinics and from those difficult field people, because, you know, they were facing our dieters and our patients every day. And what they were trying to do is articulate some of the challenges and the gaps and the things that they needed for and on behalf of these patients. It was pent up frustration, and it wasn't always kind of positively expressed. But again, if you look behind the behavior and you listened, I spent the first year at Ideal Protein, when we were in the luxurious position of being able to travel, of building trust between the Canadian business and the US business and our clinics and the Ideal Protein, you know, kind of head office, if you like. Just by having listening groups and focus groups and involving people in the evolution of the business, empowering them to own the solutions. And it was just amazing, just amazing.
Also, you just described a sort of definition for that responsibility of trustworthiness, how to do this. And what I'm hearing is that there was some truth in that place of discomfort that where some of your partners were
the
in.
We had a session one day. We had these big training weekends, and we used to bring the clinics in, and they'd listen to presentations, etc. And we'd have some breakout groups, and the coaches who work with the dieter would go and do their training, and we'd work with clinic owners. And very early on, just after I came in, we had a session with some clinic owners. And the Ideal Protein then team were presenting at these clinic owners, and I could see them all sitting there with their arms folded and looking unhappy. We ended up kind of asking most of the Ideal Protein folks to leave the room, apart from the regional manager, and with a leadership coach, behavioral expert, Maureen Pay, who I was working with. Maureen and I shut the door and we said, okay, you know, almost why the long faces. and we had a very, very difficult session with these clinic owners that people still talk about in the business today. And they're saying, oh, do you remember that awful day? And it was amazing, because out of those truths, out of that frustration, out of that sheer anger that our clinic owners had not been able to express openly for 3, 4, 5, 10 years, came just some golden nuggets of things that we could work on, issues we could address. I mean, none of them were brain surgery. They were all very addressable problems. And I always say that was a turning point in the business. And I remember one clinic owner, as we left to go back on stage, said to me, oh, you know, that was awkward. I'm really sorry we got so angry. you know, I wouldn't like to be in your shoes. And I said, I'm perfectly comfortable in my shoes here. This is my job. And, you know, your anger and your frustration will change the face of this business. And, you know, so we started slowly to rebuild trust. But it's amazing. Again, there's that kind of awful adage. I can't remember what it is. It comes in on the speed of a snail and leaves on a racehorse with regards to trust.
Right.
And I always think that's true because people are quick to judge and trust goes very quickly. But in some ways that saddens me as an adage, because things that you build over time, when you do what you say you're going to do, when you listen, when you're open, should stay. I mean, you know, when things get rocky, trust is important and it shouldn't undermine a whole relationship. It's
I really appreciate what you've just shared with us, because it's not just about trust is this, trust is that. You've shared the mechanism, very simple mechanisms.
So yeah. Sit
in a place of discomfort.
Yes.
Will enlighten you, would give you some clues that people have bottled up, haven't been able to disclose for X reason, for a diverse reason. And also you give them the space to articulate in any shape or form what the problem was. So a generous, you know, approach of giving the time to think and a space to think, the people also express themselves. And that
we tend to react to people's behavior. It's a human truth. I mean, we meet anger with anger, we meet frustration with frustration. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one of the things I've really had to learn is to, in that moment of tension, particularly because I'm British and we're also, you know, kind of on the surface, I've had to learn to just step back and listen. And, you know, when somebody's angry, there is something behind that anger. There's a passion, there's an emotion, there's a commitment. And there's usually something really, really positive. Mm. And understanding what that is, and that, you know, is fundamental to moving forward. Whereas we so often want to suppress those things and ignore them or react to them. It's like fight or flight, isn't it? When people are angry, you either fight or you kind of avoid the conflict and fly. But if you can kind of be there in the moment, like you say, sit with that discomfort, sit with that awkwardness and be curious, solutions happen.
So it's not fight, it's not flight, it's more fly. Yeah.
It's not fight or flight. It's something in the middle, isn't it?
I love it.
Yeah.
Well, that's great, because there's always it's never binary. There's always something else. Sometimes.
There's always a spectrum. Yeah,
exactly. So thank you so much for you know, really, really deep diving into that trust, but also what's behind it and how can and the kind of mechanism that we can activate fairly simply, actually, just listen and give the space.
Yes.
And be curious, coming with a positive intent, be open and recognize that everybody's unique and different. And whatever they say, you will not know the full extent of what's in their head, because there's a world and a context behind that you can't grasp in 2 minutes anyway. It's impossible.
Yeah. It's just behavioral. I don't know. I've often been accused in different roles of being a Pollyanna, because people believe that I believe in people. And, you know, I'm too positive when you know, anger erupts or frustration erupts, but it's like they're the gifts. they're the times when you learn so much. So I always have that view of, you know, just trust that there's something underneath this, trust in people, and great things happen in relationships.
Possible good antidote to stress as well in the package.
Is
there anything else we should be paying attention that you haven't covered today?
I don't think so. I think the learning applies kind of across, as you said, communities and businesses and politics and wherever. I think one of the things I saw when I was working in social enterprises, which is why I'm so keen to kind of get back into the sector, is so many folks who've set up their own businesses, so many entrepreneurs who have an idea find it difficult to kind of let go of their baby and really trust. And a couple of the great enterprises I've worked with who were really developing knew to build great teams, knew that although it was their baby, to be challenged is good, to bring in new ideas will help this baby become a healthy toddler and flourish. So yeah, it's I'm really looking forward to working around this concept, which is why I was so excited when you started to build the House of Trust.
Fantastic. Well,
I can occupy a little space in that house somewhere.
Bring your bag. Bring your bag. There's enough space for everyone. Fantastic, Mel. It was great to have you in the House of Trust. And as we continue evolving from room to room, and thank you so much for bringing your toolkit with us today.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you.